Here are solutions to homework set number one for ECE 321 Analog Electronics. Now the first problem is build an amplifier. There's a couple ways to do that. To build a gain of +4, I would use a non-inverting amplifier. And kind of one way to see that is with the negative feedback, V plus equals V minus, if this is X, this is a voltage divider. X is 1/4 of Y, which means that Y is 4 times X. For negative gain, that's an inverting amplifier. Here the input goes on the plus input, here the input goes on the minus input. This creates an inverting amplifier. With the inverting amplifier, the gain is just the ratio, R1 over R2. So for a gain of -4, make that 4 to 1. The third one is to make a gain of 12 minus 4x. That's an instrumentation amplifier. I can rewrite this as 4 times 3 minus x. So that'd be this circuit, that's equal to 4, or R1 over R2, times A minus B. So that's 4 times 3 minus X. That tells you right away, this is A, this is B. A equals 3, B equals X. The gain is 4, so pick this to be a 4 to 1 ratio. The exact value doesn't really matter. Bigger than 100 ohms, less than 10 meg. And that's problem one. Problem two is build a mixer. And there are many ways to do this. One approach is to do it in two stages. First, I'll find the weighted average of A, B, and C, call that X. And here's divided by 16 because the sum of the coefficients is 16. This way, if A, B, and C are all 1 volt, X is 1 volt. Then to clear the denominator, multiply by 16. For weighted average, it's pick a resistor. I chose 42K as my base resistance. That's the least common multiple of these three. The 42K divided by 6 is this value, 7K. 42K divided by 3 is the weighting on B. 42K divided by 7 is the weighting on C. So this will give the weighting of 6, 3, and 7, weighted average. To clear out the divide by 16, multiply by 16. That's the non-inverting amplifier that we looked at previously. Problem 3 is a push-pull amplifier. Find the output when this is 0, 1, and 2 volts. When this is 0 volts, this is 0. Well, when V1 is 0. If this is 0, V plus equals V minus, this is 0. I need 1.4 volts to turn on this diode. I don't have it, so the output is 0. When the input is 1 volt, again, this is 1 volt right here. Again, I need 1.4 volts to turn this on. I don't have it. I get 0. At 2 volts, that's more than, well, this is also 2 volts. 2 is more than 1.4, so this turns on. The output becomes 0.6 volts. 0.6 volts at 28 ohms becomes 21 milliamps. Where that comes from is most of it comes from here. Just a little bit comes from the base. So this is the output, the emitter current, divided by beta plus 1. And this guy right here is just beta over beta plus 1 times the emitter current. Basically the same. So just a little bit of current, 21 microamps, drives the speaker. And notice there's a 1.4 volt drop. If I simulate that in Circuit Lab using a sine wave input, and here I use the Darlington pairs, those are the TIP transistors. If you use a 3904, that also works. The main difference is I have a 1.4 volt drop across two diodes. I only have 0.7 across one diode, like a 3904. So here's your NPN, here's your PNP. With this circuit, if the input is a sine wave, this voltage is a sine wave. When it's between plus and minus 1.4 volts, the output doesn't respond. If I simulate that in Circuit Lab, that's what I see. So here's the input, here's the output. The difference in the two is about 1.4 volts. That's the Darlington pair. And this right here is the crossover distortion. That's something you don't want. What this means is that I've got harmonics on the output. Again, from Fourier transform, a periodic input that is not a sine wave has harmonics. My input is a pure sine wave, The output should also be pure sine wave. It's not, so I've got distortion. That's what this circuit does. If I do a very minor modification, take the minus and connect it to the speaker, that eliminates the crossover distortion. So now when the input is 0, the output is 0. When the input is 1 volt, the output is 1 volt. When the input is 2 volts, the output is 2 volts. And if I look at it in Circuit Lab, here's X and Y. So both X equals Y. What you're seeing here, this is the voltage at the base. When the NPN is turned on, the voltage at the base is the output plus 1.4 volts. When it goes negative, this is the PNP. When the PNP turns on, the base voltage is the input minus 1.4. And you get this big jump discontinuity at the zero crossing. That jump discontinuity can sometimes cause noise, but that's a push-pull amplifier. For problem 7, we're using an LM386. This is similar to a push-pull amplifier, but it's on a chip. It's an op-amp with the amplifier on it, capable of 700 milliwatts. So this will actually drive the speaker at some decent volume. If you take your cell phone to here and drive the speaker, it actually sounds pretty clear. I built a couple circuits, kind of like so. So here's where the cell phone goes in. This capacitor isn't really necessary for now. We'll use it later. This is a DC block, so if my circuit has a 4.5 volt offset, that eliminates the 4.5 volt offset. Pin 3 is where the input goes, right here. The speaker comes out at pin 8. That goes through a 220 microfarad capacitor. And these are the 8 ohm speakers. There's the amplifier. Apply a sine wave in, I get a sine wave out. Apply music in, I get music out. The other circuit over here is a 4.5 volt reference. We're going to use that later. I've got 9 volts from my battery. I've got 0 volts from the battery. I want to generate 4.5 volts. So with these two, this is just a voltage divider. Generates 4.5 volts, but it isn't capable of any current. If I connect this to a load, like 1K, I just change the circuit, change the voltage. To keep the voltage constant, use an op amp. This is a voltage follower. V plus equals V minus, so the output is 4.5 volts. What's special about this is capable of 50 milliamps. So I've got a nice clean 4.5 volt source capable of 50 milliamps. That's what this circuit does. And these are just 100 microfarad capacitors. They go between the 4.5 volts and earth ground, and another one goes between 4.5 volts and 9 volts. Helps keep the DC voltage, the 4.5 volt reference, more constant. To check that circuit, if I want to check the 4.5 volt reference, what I can do is measure the voltage right here. That's the voltage at 4.5 volts, and then take a resistor. Connect the 9 volts to the 4.5 volts, and here I chose 220 ohms. What that does, that gives me 20 milliamps, about 20 milliamps. So 4.5 volts at 220 ohms is about 20, 22 milliamps. Measure the voltage without the load and with the load. On the low side, same thing. Take a 220 ohm resistor and connect it between 4.5 volts and ground. There's your 220 ohms. Measure the voltage with and without the load. What that does is that lets you measure the output impedance of the amplifier. What it looks like is essentially I've got a plus 4.5 volt source, a 0 volt source, and a minus 4.5 volt source. This is actually the 9 volt battery and the voltage in the middle. Think Thevenin equivalent. I've got a Thevenin voltage, that's your 4.5 volts. If I measure the open circuit voltage, that's VThevenin. If I tie 220 ohms to ground, that'll measure RThevenin. When I connect this to 220 ohms, the voltage drops, goes from 4.58 volts to 4.52 volts. What that means is that I'm drawing 20.5 milliamps. That's 2.52 volts over 220 ohms. When I do that, the voltage drops by 0.06 volts. From V equals IR, that means this looks like a 2.9 ohm resistor. That's the output impedance. At minus 4.5 volts, think Thevenin. I've got a Thevenin voltage. I've got a Thevenin resistance. The open circuit voltage is minus 4.66 volts. Connect 220 ohms to ground. And the voltage drops to 4.65 volts. So I lose 0.01 volt when I draw 21 milliamps, meaning this is 0.47 ohms. So there's my plus power supply, there's my power supply. What I'm doing is checking to see what the output impedance is, how much is the voltage going to drop when I load it. Ideally, this will be zero. It's not. And this is one way to find the output impedance of your amplifier, of your power supply. Number nine is find the gain of the 386 op amp. So to do that, I'm going to apply a sine wave in. The reason for sine wave is I can use my multimeter and measure the RMS voltage. At 200 Hz, the input was 19.1 millivolts. That's from my computer. The output was 375 millivolts, so the gain is 19.63. At 1 kHz, the gain is 19.9, 5 kHz, 19.5. So that is working. I've got an amplifier with a gain of 19, yeah, basically 20. Good between 200 and 5 kHz, probably beyond that, but that's all I measured. The fun part is apply an audio signal to it. Now it's hard to take data with audio, but it's much more fun. Connect an audio signal to it, and you can actually hear some decent sound. And here's an example of the 386 op amp playing an audio sound. Words are flowing out like endless rain into a paper cup. They slip away, they pass, they slip away.